Simon & Schuster Audio presents River Horse, A Voyage Across America by William Least Heat Moon. Read by J.O. Sanders.
The boat. If you want the specifications, she was made of fiberglass laminate over an end-grain balsa core 2 inches thick, with a flat hull aft a V-shaped bow, just under 22 feet long and about 8 in beam, approximately 1,700 pounds empty, with an 8-inch minimum draft and about 30 inches when mowed and loaded, called a sea dory and built near Seattle in January 1995. The boat readily fit onto a small trailer. She had only essentials: a compass, a depth finder, paired tachometers, and gauges for each of the two 58-gallon tanks that fueled the twin 45-horsepower four-stroke Honda engines, efficient and environmentally advanced. The single window wiper worked by hand crank. Our radio was an Apelco Marine Band pocket model. To save weight and increase range, we did not fill the freshwater tank, and to avoid head duty and have another reason to stop in river towns when we came across them, we left behind the chemical toilet. The hull, with molded lap strakes to throw off spray, derived from the classic American dory, perfected in the 18th century to carry fishermen into the rough coastal waters of the Northeast Atlantic. Our sea dory was not fast, but she was stable, sturdy, maneuverable, responsive, and yar. Atop the pilot house, we carried a 9-foot, one-person Kiowe kayak for places even the shallow draft dory couldn't enter. For the shallowest rivers, we had a flat-sterned 17-foot aluminum Grumman canoe and a tiny 4-horsepower Evinrude motor, which, when off the water, traveled with the trailer. If you imagine a Maine lobster boat crossed with a turn-of-the-century harbor tug, you have our sea dory, Nikawa, a name I coined from the Osage words ni, river, and kawa, horse. Indeed, she was a tough but sweet little river horse. On the forward bulkhead near the helm, I attached a wooden plaque, a proverb from the Quakers, "Proceed as the way opens." Aft, above the door to the well deck and motors, I put up another. This one from Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness, the advice Marlowe receives before ascending the Congo River: avoid irritation. I have spent my life trying to practice such simplicities, and when I fail, paying the costs. In April of 1995, we, my co-pilot and I, set out to test the admonitions in a venture of some moment and considerable chance. Day 1. The Hudson River. For about a half a league after we came out of the little harbor on Newark Bay at Elizabeth, New Jersey, with its strewn alleys and broken buildings, its pervading aura of collapse, where the mayor himself had met us at the dock and stood before a podium his staff had fetched up for him to set his speech on. Words to launch us on that Earth Day across the continent, as he reminded us of history here, of George Washington on nearly the same date being rowed across to New York City on the last leg of his inaugural journey. And for the half league down the Kill Van Kull, where Henry Hudson lost a sailor to an arrow through the neck, we had to lay in behind a rusting Norwegian freighter heading out to sea with so little cargo that her massive props were no more than half in the water and slapping up a thunderous wake and thrashing such a royal that it sent our little teakettle of a boat rolling fore and aft. I quickly throttled back, and the following sea picked up our stern and threatened to ride over the low transom into the well deck. We had no bilge pump to empty it, and the cabin door stood hooked open to the bright blue April morning and the sea air of New York Bay. My co-pilot roared, "Don't cut the motor so fast when we're riding a swell, you'll swamp us!" Only 10 minutes out, we were nearly on our way to the bottom, 60 feet below. I turned toward the stern to see the bay rear above the transom just before the water raised Nikawa high enough to let the next wave ride under and shove her fast toward the chopping props of the freighter. Then her bow slipped down the other side of the swell. We pulled away from the big screws, and I idled to let the deep water tramp move ahead until I got an open lane on her port side. We pushed past, cut through the wake of the Staten Island ferry, and headed on toward the Atlantic.
And that's how it begins,
said my friend, a blue water sailor, one whom I shall call Pilotus. It wasn't, of course, the beginning, for who can say where a voyage starts? Not the actual passage, but the dream of a journey and its urge to find a way. For this one, I can speak of a possible inception. I'm a reader of maps, not usually nautical charts, but road maps. I read them as others do Holy Writ, the same text again and again in quest of discoveries, and the books I've written each began with my gaze wandering over maps of American terrain. At home, I have an old highway atlas, worn and rebound, the pages so soft from a thousand thumbings they whisper as I turn them. Every road I've ever driven, I've marked in yellow, the pages densely highlighted. And I can now say I've visited every county in the contiguous states except for a handful in the deep south, and those I'll get to soon. 20 years ago, I had been down enough miles of American road that I could visualize the impending end of new territory to light out for, as my fellow Missourian river traveler Huck Finn has it. And that's when I noticed the web of faint azure lines, a varicose scribing of my atlas. They were rivers. I began tracing a finger over those twistings in search of a way to cross America in a boat. At first, I was simply curious whether one could accomplish such a voyage without coming out of the water repeatedly and for many miles. But later, I grew interested in the notion of what America would look like from the rivers, and I wanted to see those secret parts hidden from road travelers. Surely a journey like that would open new country and broader notions. But I could find no transcontinental route of rivers that did not require miles and miles of portages and heavy use of border waters, the Gulf of Mexico or the Great Lakes. For my voyage, I wanted only an internal route across the nation. I'll skip details of how, during those two decades, I discovered inch by inch a theoretical route a small vessel might, at the proper time of the year, pursue westward from the Atlantic an interior course of some 5,000 miles, equivalent to a fifth of the way around the world, ideally with no more than 75 miles of portage, to reach the Pacific in a single season. Travelers have boated across America before, but never to my knowledge under those requirements. One night 16 months earlier, in a thrill of final discovery, I found what I believed to be the last piece of this river puzzle. And at that moment, I understood that I had to make the voyage, at whatever cost. If a grail appears, the soul must follow. In my excitement, I phoned my great friend to join me, teach me the bowline and sheepshank, remind me of the rules of the road, to be my co-pilot, my Polaris of the heart, who would steer me clear of desolation, that fell enemy of the lone traveler. Pilotus said, "When my father was dying a few months ago, in his last days when he was out of his head, he lay murmuring. I had to lean close to hear him. He said again and again, 'Can you make the trip? Can you make the trip? Better be ready.' It was his celestial call to board. Now you ask me the same question, and I don't know." My friend mulled things for some days and then phoned. "I can make the trip. I'll be ready. Find us a boat that can do it." And that's how we came to be on the 20th day of April, sliding past the Norwegian freighter on our way to the Atlantic Ocean. Pilotus, my Pylades, my Pythia, my Pythias. Writes well, values memorable language, quotes it as I can never do. After I had nearly sunk us within sight of our departure dock, and the ensuing embarrassed quiet played to good effect, Pilotus said as if lecturing, "Nautical charts carry a standard warning addressed to the prudent mariner. Revere that adjective above all others." I, whose boating life to that moment consisted of paddling about in a 13-foot canoe and standing below deck watches and chipping paint on a 900-foot aircraft carrier, realized more than I wished to admit why I wanted Pilotus along. But I only pointed out the worn stone walls of Fort Wadsworth on the north end of Staten Island near the Narrows. Frederick Bartholdi, sculptor of the Statue of Liberty, considered that passage the Gate of America, an opening through which 4 centuries of ships have sailed for the Canaries, Calcutta, the Southern Capes, Cathay, but few for the Pacific via inland waters. Then we crossed under the high 6-lane span of the Verrazano Narrows Bridge, the great silver gate looking improbably thin and fragile hanging above us, and pushed east beyond Coney Island and Gravesend Bay on into the ocean.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.